We've got another collaborative dialogue happening with Carl Grinter and Dr. Azra Fatherad. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for staying that long. I don't know if this is working.
It is working.
Good afternoon. Fatherad, as Opie's just for inviting us here, and that is Carl.
We got together to kind of present a kind of portrayal, really, of some things that started in a conversation that started from the Encountering Difference evening. And it was something that kind of sparked mission, which really arose from seeing something within Azada's work and the representation of self through an imaginary space, an imaginary other, an imaginary sense of something else, of something that couldn't be representable. And it sparked within me, at least, something that I'm really interested in, which is kind of the point where we reach non-representability of things, is where our kind of sensibilities kind of lose themselves and we start to kind of move into the an effective sense of space, sense of time, sense of each other, and things start to break down a little bit in terms of like the regulation of the way that we understand things.
Yeah. So we prepared a presentation collectively to refer to this topic together. I'm sorry because I'm short and this is I'm behind this. It will be a lot of visual to share with you. We will take your time about 15 minutes. We won't go over time more than a couple of minutes, I hope. And if you have any question, it seems there is a section at the end you can ask your question. But if there was any burning question at the end of our presentation, feel free just to raise your hand. You're very open for that.
One of the things that we started used as our kind of talking point was kind of things that bits of media, effectively. Ideas or thoughts, or just around this idea of representation, around this idea of what is different in terms of what we see as difference and the way that it creates movements from one thing to another, you know, in effective kind of ways that help us understand ways to the way that we might normally understand things. It, effectively, I think it is really about the way that we kind of deal with contingency. Where we deal with the unknown things that we don't really kind of understand, but we try to represent, and the way that we kind of move forward in the journey.
Yeah, in our series of Skype and meetings, we try to understand one another's work, and also how we reflect one another when we encounter another person with a different work, within a different narrative, within a different context. As you can see, like for instance in this video, the faces are sort of dissolving to one another to become another person or to be a reflection of someone else's project or someone else's talent. Through this presentation today, you will see how we try to be open to one another, how we try to contextualize what the person does and become a visual language and also a sort of an intellectual vocabulary selection. In the next slide, which I'll show you in a minute, is a selection of the keywords that has been coming up through our conversations. Here, for instance, the differences or the indifferences, revealing or openness or closeness, accepting these boundaries or limitation. And also we realize one of the things in every encounter is a potential of working together, but also potential of pain, potential of how we can embed the other person within our rhythm, but also we are also accepting the opportunity to suffer in certain points.
I think it's really important, we've been talking about this today actually, which is the idea of how we kind of bridge those gaps between, you know, intersubjective kind of senses of one another. And one of the things that we found really interesting is this kind of idea of how you host other people you kind of subtly host them within your own kind of sense of self that allows you to kind of reflect upon the way that they are and the way that you are, yet subsequently because of the way they are. It's kind of, you only understand yourself because of the way that you reflect yourself by through the understanding of other people. And that was a really kind of try to see in the combination of also the way that we approached it in a different way, and reflect that as a kind of way to open up and sort of learn from each other in a sense, just through the way that you talk about stuff in the everyday. So this is one of the kind of pieces of media that we kind of both connected with. We've been sharing quite a lot of stuff that we kind of liked, that represented kind of the portrayal of difference and the way that we could kind of like portray each other or portray other things or actually open yourself up to stuff. And this is kind of like a, you know, I think it says what it says. But what it does is sort of say something about when things break down and we have to kind of rely on trying to make up things as they are in that moment, but also what happens after that moment, how our journeys begin from these moments when we open up to things and open up to other people.
On the fourth day of our mission, I think it was, I went outside the spacecraft to test the portable life support system, the backpack which contained all the oxygen and cooling and radio and all that.
Okay, Dave, come on up.
Okay, taking pictures of everybody taking pictures.
When Dave Scott, who is photographing this from the command module, said, "Hey, I just had a camera jam. It failed. Can I take 5 minutes to try and unjam the camera?" And Jim McDivitt, who was the commander of the flight, said, "Okay, Dave, take 5 minutes. Rusty, don't move." So there I was with 5 minutes when Dave was busy, Jim was busy doing something, and I literally had nothing to do except just look at where I was. No sound, nobody was talking, completely silent. And here, 17,000 going across the surface of the Earth, a beautiful planet down below me. And I decided this was the time when I really, my responsibility was simply to really let all of that come in. What was happening? What was going on? And so all of a sudden, here I am looking at this planet below me and saying to myself, here I am, a little farm boy from New Jersey, and then here I am in space. So all of these questions just came flooding mind. I mean, what am I doing here? How did I get here? What does this mean? Who am I? What does it mean when I say I? I mean, this is really a very special thing with life moving out from the Earth. And that's an amazing moment in the history of evolution. So now all of that, I suppose I went too far, because at that time, all I was doing was to the experience. It was afterward that I really realized that the questions which came to me at that moment had a lot more in them, and the experience fed those questions much more deeply than I ever analyzed at the moment. I didn't come up with all sorts of conclusions. I was just trying to open up to the experience.
To experience. That was how I learned about Carl's work. And it's not my turn. It's Carl's turn.
So one of the things we like the idea of doing is trying to, rather than get each other to talk about our work, is to try and get the other person to talk about their work. And we've kind of prepared some kind of thoughts, and we're just going to try and portray that. I have to kind of approach Asda's work with, from my own perception, in the own way that I already feel. And I'm a person who gets really overexcited about stuff,
It's just a natural kind of way that I am about things. And things that really move me, they tend to make me speechless. Because I think it's the point where the way that you represent things kind of breaks down. And I love the way, and it's the way, the human way that we kind of understand the world starts to break down through language, when you can't kind of say the words. But the thing that really, really moves me is when you see activity of people coming together as in a joint action to actually transform something, or try to transform something, whatever that may be. Because it kind of it's the point where the intellectual space becomes something that everybody inhabits. It kind of moves into the kind of the intellectual space. Saying a little bit about Azada's work from that context. It kind of represents to me the kind of movement between the documentary and the analytical and the personal creation of that imaginary space of self-representation, the way that we kind of move, that movements are created. And I think that this and the showroom 2015 are a great example of this, because it was came from a project titled the Iran's Women's Movement on the archive of Siddiqui Dawala Tabadi. Azada conducted a 4-year international research project on somewhat neglected Dawala Tabadi, who was born in Isfahan in 1882, and she's the founding mother of Iranian feminism, as well as the effect on the work on women's enlightenment in Iran in the early 20th century, and its relevance to the contemporary context of women's life in post-revolutionary Iran, from 1979 to the present. Project, she's done extensive kind of archival research, and that's enabled her to kind of produce these amazing sort of narratives, which enable her to kind of, through her imagination, represent the experiences of other people and what it would have been like. And that was something that I really kind of connected with, because it had a very kind of real quality to it. It was something that you kind of could latch onto and you could mediate with. And the exhibitions and the works that I've seen, they create a resonance that makes you think about things long after the event. And we're going to show a little clip of this afterwards from the feminist historiography that was undertaken in Stockholm. Effectively, other experience to portray the experiences of some of women in the feminist movement in Iran. And perhaps we should move on to show that clip. That would be lovely. Stop me talking.
Flowers.
No one is thinking about
the
fish.
No one is thinking about the fish.
No one is thinking about the fish.
No one is dying.
No one is dying.
That the garden's heart is swollen under the sun. And that the garden's mind is slowly being drained of green memories.
And that the garden senses are separate things. Rotting huddled in a corner.
Rotting huddled in a corner.
Our old courtyard is lonely.
No one.
Our garden yawns in anticipation of an unknown rain cloud.
No one.
And our pool is empty.
No one.
Inexperienced little stars fall to the earth from tree-topped heights.
Lonely.
And from our pale windows of the fish, the sound of coughing comes in the night.
Our garden is lonely. Father says, it's too late for me. It's over for me. I shouldered my burden and I did my share. And in this room, from dawn to dusk, he reads either the shamane or the history of histories.
Lonely.
Father says to mother, to hell with all birds and fish.
Mother.
When I die, then what difference will it make that there is my garden or that there isn't a garden?
Mother.
My retirement pension is not there for me.
Mother. Mother's whole life is a prayer room, a threshold of fear and hell. At the bottom of everything, mother always searches for traces of sin and thinks that a plant's apostasy has contaminated the garden.
Pray.
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 Mother prays all day long.
Pray.
Mother is a natural sinner, and
pray.
She breathes on all the flowers
pray.
And on all the
pray.
Fish and exercises
pray.
Herself.
Pray.
Mother is waiting
pray.
For her coming and the
pray.
Forgiveness
Lonely.
To descend upon
pray.
The earth.
Pray.
And calls
pray.
The garden a graveyard.
Pray.
My brother laughs at the profusion
pray.
Of weeds and keeps a count of the fish corpses that decompose
pray.
Beneath the water's thick skin.
Pray.
My brother
pray.
Is addicted,
addicted
to philosophy.
Addicted.
Addicted.
My brother
pray.
Thinks
addicted.
The cure for the
pray.
Garden
addicted.
Lies
addicted.
In its destruction.
Addicted.
He gets drunk
addicted.
And bangs on
addicted.
Doors and walls
addicted.
And tries to say that he...
So this is a portrayal of Azada's
very warped.
Azada's narrative by other people, which kind of... gives a whole new sense to the way that we can represent from that point of view.
Yes, ladies and gentlemen, we are floating in a space. That was how I learned about... I'm going to turn on the light. It's going to be very sharp, so mind your eyes. Oh, okay. Yeah? And the work of Carl's is very much to do about openness and how we experience our life in everyday moment of it. One of the things that I learned from Carl was the idea of optimism and the fluidity in experience of the life and how we take the encounter to something special and how we turn it to become something that we were not thinking about. One of the works that I have seen from Carl is called Thesis, which is the archival footages he has gathered from the NASA archive online, which is open access. But the idea of how you choose from that is same as how you choose your encounter, like somebody you want to work with, or how you make that, how your agency plays in between to decide what you will take further. In this work, it's a fascinating journey that reconstructs and reinterprets the Apollo 11 lunar mission across six chapters. In this film, it's a very slow movement. It's the journey, a 2 hours film, which is not fast forwarded. You will experience the whole process. And this is coming from his experience that he had growing up as a child, witnessing this important happening within the in the media. So the power of media in the human experience was very permanent in his. What was present in this video work was the idea of encountering a massive amount of audiovisual archive, and then how to make the narrative out of it. That is sort of reasonably understandable, and also it leads to a different experience for the viewer. So you will have a voiceover which narrates the story, but also we have moments of silence that we need to embed the idea of what is happening in that space, which is an unknown space, known place, and somewhere that we would not imagine as a human being to travel to. So another rhythm of experiencing an encounter or unknown space of being with one another or another place. No. So here I'm going to show you a very short video, because we didn't want to show you the 2 hours film because we had 20 minutes for video. But you are welcome to contact us if you want to see the whole film of Carl. But this film that I'm going to show you, it resonates our sort of overlap of interest, and primarily we want to share that part with you today. So I'm going to show you a very short clip, and then I'll describe you what is this one about.
Well, it's you, isn't it? You've got the best one at the moment, haven't you?
No, she's absent most of the time. So, yeah, not great at the moment.
Okay, well, I've definitely got the worst one at the moment.
I don't know. So I think we're competing in that stage.
Yeah.
I have a girlfriend. She's also the mother of my child.
She's not around.
She's not around, but we've still only had sex 5 times since Jack was born.
Why is she not around?
He's how old? He's 10 months old.
Oh, that's normal. What's wrong with that?
Yeah, I guess that's probably normal.
I don't think that's normal.
Oh, that is absolutely normal. Do you want more?
Yeah.
Presumably, yeah.
No, I'm having real trouble with it. I have a massively high sex drive.
Where does she live? Does she live with you?
No, we don't live with each other. But it's to the point where, you know, I'm offering it on a plate and she's not.
Oh my God. No. I just thought, oh my God, after I had my kids, I just felt like a piece of meat.
Get off me. Don't touch me.
But there obviously is something wrong with me, because all throughout our pregnancy, I was really horny.
There's absolutely nothing wrong with you. That's very good.
And afterwards, you can't do it for 6 weeks, or you're not supposed to, really. And that was really difficult for me.
She sounds like a lucky woman.
Yeah. After she was healed up. But, you know. Well, anyway, I've just never had to work this hard to get someone to sleep with me.
Have you tried talking to her?
Sort of. Thing is, if it's psychological, I don't want to scare the vagina away.
Right.
And I was worried it was me, but it isn't me, because we had a little chat about it and she was just like, no, I'm just really stressed out at the moment. And, you know, when she gets that stressed, the first thing's an appetite. But still, at the same time, I feel massively sexually rejected, and I've never felt like that before. Because let's face it, it's women. And, you know, even if they don't fancy you, if you said come on, they would.
Really? I'm gonna try that.
They do get stressed. I mean, it does depend on stress, but yeah, I mean, sometimes they can't. You know, they can't.
It's just never happened to me.
But no, I mean, it hadn't happened to me, and you know, but until there was one girlfriend. I can't remember who it was. it was a girl.
Name her.
And yeah, it happened. But you do. You sort of think, there's something wrong with me.
Yes, that's how I feel. It was, you know, I understand that she's under pressure from all sides, but I still feel...
But that's the release, isn't it?
Well, yeah.
Don't you need that release?
Yeah.
When you're under pressure? Well, you would have a way to relax.
You would have thought so. You've got to shag it out.
Shag it out.
Yes! But she's just the type of person that can't relax or turn off in any situation.
She's self-employed?
Yeah.
Well, there you go.
I know I need your love, hold over me.
Okay. Yeah, that was the word called lucky woman. So do you think the conversation was guys speaking about themselves? Who thinks that was guys speaking about themselves? Just raise your hand. The conversation was a natural conversation of guys talking with one another, or what? My question doesn't make sense. Okay, so this was anonymously recorded of women conversation, and turned to be reenacted by guys. So it was what women would say to another where they were sitting with each other, and that was recreated by actors to sort of reflect on that differently. That's made by Luke
Forsyth
and Christine Larson project, and sort of it refers to what if women speak, what if men spoke women's words and woman men's words. What would be different? What would be the same? Or how would it challenge our pre-assumptions and preconceptions? It's not me, it's you is an ongoing project built from anonymously recorded conversations performed by the opposite gender. So this form, we realize in this sort of production, it actually crosses that idea of the dichotomy of between men and woman or the other person, and how they have sort of embodied that within the conversation, and actually it looks okay. Like I wouldn't question that if guys are talking about this subject in this way, because it also comes across very naturally. We shall end here, and we said the sort of we could reflect on our lack of interest in our projects. And what we are going to do, we are offering you a beautiful animation to finish with. And that's, hello, come inside. That would wrap up what both of us has presented so far. Do you want to say something?
Yeah, this is an animation by Nick Parker, Aardman Animation. It's from 1989, a piece of observation. Taking, again, natural recorded conversations and interpreting them, and within that interpretation, I think that's you know, that's where difference kind of evolves from. It's like, you know, the way we understand, the way we kind of like actively involved in the world through our gestures and our movements, that's our interpretation. That's the way we try to interpret everything. You know, when we can't understand, oftentimes the one thing that happens to us is there's a break in our movement. Conscious kind of activity stops, movement stops. We have this moment of surprise, and everything can begin again from that point. And I think that's what we see when we see surprising things, when we see media that helps us understand different things in a different way, in a new way. It's all about newness to me. It's this amazing thing that just stops us in our tracks and allows us to kind of then reflect and kind of build our own journeys into the future and the possibility that can bring. Right? This is a good example of that.
Yeah, it was reasonably comfortable, I suppose, the space, but I mean, I've been in more comfortable rooms, yes.
If you try to compare the situations and the environment with the environment that you live in Brazil, there is a big difference. Here, you live in a very small place with all the technological advances possible. You have everything sorted out, double glazing, you know, your heating and everything in Brazil, but you don't have space. In Brazil, you have space. Although you don't have all this technological, you know, double glaze and things like that, and you know, but you have, and we need space to live. We know that we are part of the world and not a kind of piece of object in a box.
My room is a bit too small, really, and I've got so much stuff in it that if I get anything new, there's just nowhere to put it.
Well, sometimes you can't get out and about as much as you would like to. You're stuck in for some reason, like I'm stuck in today. And then, yes, you get bored and you get fed up with looking at the same four walls.
I try to spend as little time in here as possible. If I can't actually get out and about, so I'm used to escape into books and things.
I feel and well looked after, very well looked after, and I'm not worried about anything. I know whatever happens, they'll look after me and put me where I ought to be.
Okay, thank you for listening, yes.
Yeah, well, it's reasonably comfortable, I suppose.
Do you have any question that you need to ask right now? You can wait if that's okay. Can I ask you? Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you to both of you. If we can have next up Viviana Troya, please. If you want it darker, just put off, and then if not, the room number two.
Okay.
So here we go.
Hello, everyone. My name is Vivian, and I wanted to share four works that I think are quite important for my practice, and I was thinking about this symposium and how it was supposed to be lens-based artists and how I'm not a photographer, although I love taking photographs and everything with my phone and everything, but how my practice could be considered as lens. Why was that important? And so this is a work I made last year. And it's an arrangement of security camera images that are showing like waiting rooms or places with chairs, basically. And I was thinking how, when you think about it, like any place could be a waiting room. And so we have here actually like waiting rooms, rooms, bars, churches, like all kinds of places. And this is a live video streaming. So I think that's really important. And here I'm thinking of like this surveillance of society and the surveillance of our time, really, when we think about it. I mean, we are sitting here waiting for this event to happen, and so everybody else is, like, no matter what place or what context, like looked from this perspective, this vertical perspective, like god-like perspective, kind of makes our experiences quite similar and quite homogeneous, I think. So I was hoping to think of this and hear and make sound like their lives and their time and this. This is an installation, like interactive installation. It's a wooden door with a peephole. So whenever people look through this peephole, they see themselves from the back. Again, in real time. So it's just like a CCTV. And here I was thinking more of like our notions of identity and how, so sure, I mean, if we're sure of something, it might be of ourselves, but then how looking at your back is quite disturbing and kind of troubling, and there's like this strange familiarity. And I think that this is something to do with like the construction of our identity and how it's actually constructed in the encountering of the others. Because, you know, like the back is something probably everyone has seen of us, but we haven't. So I thought that this was like a good way to make people think about this, like how you define yourself. This is a kind of work in progress I wanted to share. It's an intervention, a commission I had. It's like opening next month, and it's an intervention in a gallery of a museum. And what I'm doing here is like I'm timing the people, measuring the time people spend in a gallery where there's like the permanent collection of the museum. And so I'm timing like the presence of people in this space, and I'm showing like in this small screens that are going to be like at the entrance and exit of that room, I'm showing people the time the person before them spent in that room. So it's kind of you're seeing like the time that people spend before you, or the person before you, like in a countdown backwards. And the way I'm doing it, or why I'm including this here, is because I'm using cameras with like facial detection that are to time the presence of people. I also will have like a collection of the times in an online platform. And though I made with NASA, that was mentioned before in Carl's work, I'm going to show it to you. I took the images of the sun that NASA has put online, and I took a whole year, the time of a whole year, to produce the video. And I put it together with text questioning about our concepts of time and how we perceive time and how like our individual concepts of time vary a lot. Whether we think, I mean, we tend to think that time's like one this thing that we all share, but I think basically everyone has this different perception of time, and we changing temporalities all the time, especially now that we're all the time, our laptop, computers, cell phones, and all sorts of technologies that I think they run different temporalities. And I put like the notification sounds and also. And I only included these four works because I thought it was going to be a very like more brief presentation. But so I wanted to conclude about how I think like the encountering difference in my work would be more about like our encounter within the collective, within the society we live in and with the other, and how our individual construction or like the construction of our identity plays a key role when encountering the others, or with the others. And yeah, how I've been using, I think, lenses that are not mine. I mean, these are not my cameras. These are just taken from other people's lenses. And here, well, I mean, I just thought it would be interesting to see how you can do lens-based work without actually having to take photographs. And because I think that's the way we're actually participating in society, you know, with our phones and everything. I think it works this way. And well, that was it. Thank you.
Thank you, Viviana. Can we next have up Pamela Breda, please?
Can you hear me? Right, okay. So also mine is going to be a short presentation. I guess I'm not really good with timing. So I calculated it wrongly, I guess. Anyway, I'm just going to show you some stills of some of my video works and a brief video of one of those. So it's going to be four works. My background is in academia as an art historian, so I've been working a lot with images and stories and narratives. And I guess over the years I developed this kind of critical approach to images and how images tells a story and narrates a story. And the fact that I believe basically, you know, images can always retell a story, and each time is going to be different. So I have this idea that you cannot really tell a story from one point of view. It's actually multiple, infinite point of views. And as an artist, I just a way to approach a material or approach a story through images, with images. And because I have my own point of view, but it is limited because I am just a single individual. So I guess for me, as just to refer to something that was said before today, I think really the artist has the we have the responsibility to create this criticality in the mind of the people, you know, but just putting question marks, I guess, in the mind of the people. So these images is from a work I'm currently now, as it is in post-production movie, I realize in Scotland, because I was doing a residency there last year, and I had already been very interested in Scotland history because of the changing social, political, and economical scenario that area, that region underwent, especially in the past 200 years, which was very, I mean, it changed a lot in this span of time. So this summer I spent some time looking at different art, and eventually the last day I was there before going back home, I discovered this archive in the National Museum of Scotland. which is to me incredibly interesting because basically it's a national archive, but it is constructed as a like a huge collective diary. So you have a lot of photographic albums with photographs, with notes, with essays from magazines, and everything from history, like costumes, stories, people. So you would have all these albums in indexy size. I don't know if that's the right word. Anyway, so I went back basically and to realize this short movie only about these archives and these albums. And it's also quite interesting because these are all photographs of other photographs. So they are reproductions of original images. And I spoke extensively with the curator, and basically she explained to me that a man started this project like back in the 80s, this tech collection of material, and then like private people just went there and donated their family images to the archive. And it's also quite interesting because a lot of these images has this kind of because of they were kind of stitched to the albums, and then they were reproducted. And so I went there to film a lot of like hours of footage inside this archive, and I'm now editing it to tell my point of view of this story, but actually referring also to the dialogues I had with the curators in the museum, and also documentation I gathered from like my research about Scotland history. Because I'm always in this kind of, I'm always questioning my position when I'm working on a subject because of what I just said before. So when I encounter an archive like this, or a story that I think is, for me, it's so interesting, I want to spread it, you know, because I normally work with material that is quite unknown. So this archive is completely, maybe every day I was there shooting, there were just two people, like scholars, studying stuff. But this is public, it's part of the, but obviously no one knows about this. So for me, it's very important to let these things be known to like more people as possible. Then this is another project I'm working on as part of my PhD research, which is called How to Catch a Star. And it's looking at the connections between art, science, and creativity. So as an artist, I'm approaching the science, in particular astronomy and astrophysics. And I've been traveling around Europe in astronomical research centers and realizing a series of interviews and talks with astronomers and astrophysics. These in particular are some video stills from an archive of astrophotography, which is basically old photography on glass plates in Italy. And it's very, very interesting because when I'm speaking with the scientists, it's like speaking with artists. So I do think that there is this connection, which is basically like the wonder, wondering about, yeah, they wonder about what's out there in the space. But the approach they have is really, I would say, obsessive as an artist that is trying to work on a subject or through a media to explore all the different possibilities. And I'm also looking at this in terms of the philosophy of science debates. So I'm looking at texts by, for example, the philosopher Karl Popper. He spoke extensively about what he calls the demarcation problem, which is basically the line that differentiates science from non-science. So what is actually the borderline there? Because I've been interviewing scientists that were in the team that got the Nobel Prize for physics, and there is a lot of debate going around the topics that also, you know, they've been researching for all their lives. And it's very, very interesting to speak with them to kind of, I realize these performative talks kind of to pushing them to the borders of the reasoning or like questioning their own methodology. This is interesting for me as a story to kind of explore. And sometimes I'm also fascinated by the story of spaces or particular places. Like this is a cinematic archive in Switzerland, I realized this short movie this summer there. And this project is called Like Magic because the name of this space is in German, is Licht, which is the translation for like magic, which is the old term used in German to describe cinema, which I thought is really beautiful as a concept. And so also the I like the idea of exploring the spaces because also I think the spaces as a story. And it's interesting the way that people are working in this archive are kind of dealing with this material because they old projection, from very old projection to new projection, and they also restore archival material, also from family home movies. So that's quite fascinating for me as a story to tell of a space. And yeah, the last thing I'm going to show you is this movie I made this summer in Switzerland. A year and a half ago, I was there for residency. And like the last week of this residency in Bern, which is the capital of Switzerland, I saw this DVD shop. And on the shop window was it said a Dr. Strangelove DVD shop. And so I entered and I asked, there was this young guy running the shop, and I asked him something about this shop because he seemed to me always full of people and very peculiar. And he said to me, yeah, I'm Dr. Strangelove, and every day you can come here in my studio and I will do the doctor for you. And I said, well, what do you mean? Like, for everyone, he said. You come here and you tell me your problems and I will tell you the movie you have to watch to be better. And which actually I tried, and it was really, you know, yeah, striking. He kind of did this psychological analysis of me, quite striking. And then he started telling me his story, that basically he wanted to run for mayor in Bern, which is, which actually he did, for two times, and now he's running for the third time. He just said this to me like a couple of weeks ago. And so these are all stills from details of his shop, which is basically full of these images about cinema history. I'm just going to show you the trailer of the movie quickly. It's like a couple of minutes. Is this to have the full screen? At the top. Yeah. Right.
I was raised in a Catholic society in which wasn't allowed to speak during having lunch. So I was forced to listen to the radio, and it was always with a lot of political news. And so I was almost 3 or 4 years old to understand it. So when I got 6 years old, I wanted to become a member of Swiss government. Then when I was 16, I have organized panel discussions with very famous Swiss politicians. I have joined a party, the Young Liberals, which is like an economic party, because I didn't know movie at this moment. I was like I was risen, means a product of my parents, of my society. But then when I turned 20, I got to know movies and art, and this has changed my view on society. And then after I've started to watch movies, 6 years later, the movie store, which I have now, so 8.5 years. And then I was very... like a priest who is on the mission to spread the knowledge of movie history.
and is it on? Can you hear me? Yeah. So this title is a quotation by Stephen himself. He's called Stephen Tyler, this guy you just heard speaking, and it's a reference to Frank Capra. That's one of his favorite movie directors, because that's Truffaut called Frank Capra the Wonder Doctor. And Stefan is kind of also relating a lot to Frank Capra, because in his story, Frank Capra, in his movies, he tells a lot about the fighting of like a single individual against corrupted society, for example. And Stefan sees himself a lot in this position. And a year how to make this movie, because of the thing I didn't want to have the idea of approaching this subject as a kind of look on something peculiar or weird, because he's very strong personality, Stefan, but somehow also an outsider, because he's very poor and he's very he's very intelligent, but he has this strong, he's really believes that he can change, I mean society can change for the better. Experience with people, taking time with people, looking movies and getting knowledge from the movie. So it's very utopic, his idea of thinking. And I wanted to present him in the most delicate ways as possible, not to have my presence as an author to kind of say anything about him, just to let his story be known. So yeah, I guess that's it.
Okay, last but not least, Liu Wen. So if you want it off, just press it off. We're at 2 right now. Okay. So make sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah.
I'd always miss the presentation.
Mm. Yeah. Mm. Hi. I'm short. Hi everyone, I'm Liu Wen. I'm lucky I'm the last one. And I'm doing MA Fine Art Digital course in Camberwell now, so I'm the student here. My topic is about time and space, because sometimes I call it space, and sometimes I call it place, and I will explain later. Because I have been longing for research into video art for a long time, and I have been doing on the topic of time and space or place in video art, but now I would like to get involved in performance art and installation art. Because I combine with performance and the installation forms of time and space very differently. What I want to discuss now is how installation and performance extend the concept or perception of time and space when they combine with video. Let me show you my works first. An instruction from Yoko Ono, I regard this one as the beginning of the space which I have been working on. It was finished in 2016 and is a performance video. I stood in a special design case for 6 hours within a fixed period of time from 2 p.m. to 8 p.m. in 4 different places. And I recorded the whole process by using a moving camera, and one of my friends helped me to film. The special design case, which means the case has the same height and same width with me. this is the first location I did a performance. It was in Wuhan, a province, the Hubei province in China. The location is the entrance of Optical Valley Square Tube Station in Wuhan. And I will play a little bit for you.
You're gonna play Hannes as an engineer.
I choose this place because the target is young people, because most of them are students, are college students, and there are many universities nearby. As you can see, not many people were interacting with me, but the guy in blue shirt, he interacted with me. He gave me his wallet, his ID cards, and his pocket, and some papers. But when I came out, he told me he is disabled people, and he showed his disabled certificate. I mean, the disabled is the brain disabled. But unfortunately, the performance did here just last 1 hour because the security guards, they stopped us. They were very angry with me. And they call themselves security guards, but I don't think so. In my eyes, I think they are gangsters. And he asked me to show our student ID cards. This is the second location I performed this performance. I choose this place because the target is obviously is children. It was very different from the first location. I was so happy they interacted with, but at first I was so happy they can touch my hands and do something with my hands. But when they were sure the hands and the books were safe, they began to do some very disgusting thing and they made me feel very painful. Sometimes they burned my fingers and kicked the books and pushed the books with their and with some
something very hard. And some children, they put something, I don't know, into the holes. And sometimes I felt I was about to fall down. I hold the box with my whole body so that it wouldn't fall down. The end has the same with the previous one. The security guy stopped us. The performance in this place lasted 3 hours. Because many residents, they complain about me. They explained the children are good at imitating, and after going home, they will imitate this behavior. Yeah, this lady is very angry with me. Yeah, the first location, some people advised our school, but in this one, this lady asked me to do this performance in the property company. It's the third location I choose. The target is the old and the people who don't have much education. But the most interesting for me was a performance, another performance artist, who is also my friend. He joined me and do a performance with me. It's a local market in Wuhan. Actually, I think the magic, the box will be a magic, and someone will come out, give them a magic, but I let them down. This is a guy, it's another performance. Before he came, he just knew I would do a project for 4 days and in four different places, but I didn't know when he would come and what he would do with me. When I felt my fingers were twinged by some strings, I realized that perhaps it was him. And this performance in this location lasts 2 hours and a almost 2 hours and a half. Yeah, some security guys stop us. They asked me to do this performance outside. Uh, this is the last location I choose. The target is no one. It's in the wood. But I didn't realize that guy come again. And he did a blood performance with my fingers. And he used his blood to, he cut himself and used his blood to paint my nails, like nails polishing. When I came out, I saw all my nails were red, and he told me it's his blood. Yeah, only in this place I did the for six hours, because no one stopped me. I forgot to mention it. The material of this box is was found in an engineering factory where my father is working at. And I painted red with a brush, and I dig it two holes. This is the first performance for me, and then when I came in London, I want to discover if I do a performance in London, what's the difference between when I do the performance in China. And the second performance, and it's also the first performance in London, is how long is the London Bridge? I use my body to measure the length of London Bridge and record the whole process by a camera. Then I found the length that is 146 my body is, and the length from my knee to toe. So the result is 146 and a quarter. When is my surname? So I think the length of a bridge is not calculated by meters or kilometers, it's by my surname. Yeah, it was finished in last year, in September or October. This girl is my classmate, and she helped me to calculate. When I did the performance here, I think the people, they work and come, they come and go, they smell to me, they are very friendly. In China, no one like me. And I think there is another time concept in it, because how long is the bridge? How long is the London Bridge? The time is 44 minutes and 44 seconds, and I think it's also how long, the answer for the how long is the London Bridge. And recently, I'm doing a series performance with a canvas. The first one is called Sleep Drawing. I lie down on the white canvas in the studio for 1.5 hours. As I do this, my camera records the whole process. Once finished, I hang on the canvas on the wall and use a projector to show the whole process. This picture is photo by my friends, and is in the exhibition. The screen, the white screen, is exactly the white canvas. Okay. Thank you. This is a process what I am doing this performance. Because in that exhibition, all my friends are painters, and they painting. But I think I'm a video artist, so I need to do something. Have some connection with them. So I choose to use the canvas and did a performance, and then I hang on the wall. And I think in contemporary area, do you think what kind of painting is painting? Do you think my paintings is also a painting? So I want to ask this question. It's a live performance, which I did in a gallery. This performance is also with the canvas, shake hands drawing. I dig two holes on the white canvas and put it in a collar to form a triangle space. Then I stand in a small space for 1.5 hours in order to shake hands with the visitors. And in the background, an audio device is playing two tones, a voice of film of female and the male. It was the performance did in LCC last week, but it's over now. Like this. Oh, thank you.
Okay, right, so I should really say that that Liu, Viviana, since it's getting really late now, I think we're the only three that picked each other, so that's why you were matched and put in this group, because each of you found each other's work interesting, so that was rare to find a three. So perhaps you can talk about why and what you found interesting in each other's works.
Well, I guess when I saw the works of Viviana and you, I guess they resonated. Maybe it's the only way I can really describe it. I found them interested for different ways. Well, in case of Viviana, I guess this idea about looking at otherness, I don't know if this word exists in English, but this idea of, yeah, looking at the others, because I guess that resonates with my own practice, because I'm really interested in stories, and in the story I always have this thing that I kind of project this idea that the others are always interesting stories and interesting lives. So I guess it's like, oh, this person must have such an interesting life. So I guess I have that kind of fascination with other people's lives, and that's, I guess, what I transpose into my video works. And I guess in that case, there was for me this resonance that I found really interested in a practice. And in case of Liu, the otherness as the artist or the performer. And it's very striking, but it's also delicate what she does. It's very you know, it's not, I mean, even in the box piece, I don't know what, I don't remember the title, but that's very powerful, but it's just a box with two arms stretching outside of it. And it's very affirmative as a piece, I guess, but without doing anything special. And I really agree with, you said all art is political. You don't really need to speak about immigration. I think, I mean, for something to be political is also what, you know, sex is political. Yeah, I totally agree. So I guess also this very, yeah, I really like it. And I think it's very powerful by being very delicate. I guess also for my own personal taste for an art work is this, while you do something very delicate, but it is very powerful. And I think both of them are doing that. So, well, I don't know.
I think I agree with what you just said. I think I thought we were sharing this concern about time and space with both of you and what revolves around it. So I think we have different approaches to time and space, but like the concern is the same. So I think that was like the main reason. Also, I felt like in their work, there's like this sensitivity or this, yeah, subtleness to doing things that become gestures or like small things become very powerful. So I thought that was, I think that was the reason why I thought we could work. I would like to work with them.
For me, I think why I choose Viviana and because his work, the door, that one, and it's an interactive work. So I'm quite interesting how they interact with people because I always hide myself and I didn't see anything when I do the performance. So I want to know something interactive with audience. So I choose her because I want to have a further conversation with her. And for you, I remember you showed me some photography and then you turned to like a video artist. So I quite surprised and curiously about your turn point. So can you talk a little bit about it?
Yeah, well, I didn't show you any photographic past work. I have one project in my portfolio, but I show you just very short selection because there was not a lot of time. But yeah, I started as a photography artist and I for like 3 or 4 years, I just worked on photographic project and did a lot of artist books. And then 6 years ago, I just stopped taking photographs because I started to question my own position about that. And then I started to think, the world is so full of images. Do I really want to put other images inside this world full of images? And eventually what really made me start working almost exclusively with videos, I do also some installation, but is because I guess to tell stories, that's the best medium for me now at the moment. The inherent narrative that video has, I guess, is the best way for me to convey what I want to say now. Now, the only lacking again with images, but completely in a completely loose images, but I work with vintage images that I found mainly in book and vintage publications, and I transform them through a scanning process. Because I have to say, yeah, I am a bit, I guess, again, critical about the fact that an image is a single representation of something. And for me, that's very, I don't know how to explain this in English, it's too much authority as a point of view, because it's just singular. And I guess, and as an art historian, because my background is in art history, I mean, you know, images are always political. And so again, they always convey a whole world behind them, culturally, sociologically, politically, gender-related. And so that's, I guess, what made me experiment them in a new way, kind of transform them into something else. So basically they become like sculpture, this scanned version that I made of this old material. Actually, this is a long time project. It's called Time Confuses the Memory of Things. And actually you see all these deformed, you know, images. Because, yeah, I guess this is all my theoretical background that comes into play. And, yeah, that's why I stopped producing images, went on and, you know, working with movies.
Okay, so let's just move on quickly or briefly to Carl and Azada, thinking about newness. It seemed like you guys really found an interesting connection with each other's work and you learned something new. So do you want to continue that conversation?
There's one there. So we should answer a question or describe?
We're going to continue with asking some questions.
Oh, I have to continue asking you a question. Okay, Carl, what was your interest in my work or what happened?
My interest came out of the idea of the taking Azada's personal narrative and then being able to have that portrayed, or have other people portray it, giving them the kind of space to reinterpret that and then express that in their own way. And I think that what I really love about that is the idea of it creates movement. And I think that that's what really kind of connected me with Azada in the first place, was her general approach and orientation to the world, which is something that's really it's something I always try to pick up on, is how do people kind of like move in space, how do they kind of actually approach things, and therefore how's that replicated in the way that they actually express themselves. So she challenges you from the very off. It's great challenging you, you know. She's kind of trying to sort of challenge your own perception of yourself, if you see what I mean, because she's trying to like open you up to something, because she's making an effort, she's actually being active about it. It's a dynamic process. So when, you know, people do that in all sorts of different ways, and there's a real maybe that's something we were touching on earlier, there's a kind of sense of, when you do that in a really good way and open people up so that they don't close down, you find out the simplicity of things about, you know, there's a fragile kind of sensitivity to it, and it brings out the humanity in people, because it's a structure of care, if you see what I mean. In trying to make the effort, you structure things in the care by allowing other people to kind of come out of themselves. And I think that's like an amazing thing. Bowing of things is like the most amazing thing to do. So that's why, you know, my approach to difference is kind of really important to me, because I'm challenging myself and my own kind of biases and my own kind of sense of where I'm coming from in order to learn, you know, to find out new things. Because it excites me, basically. I get really kind of like, wow, that's, you know, the idea of wonder that we've been kind of talking about, you know. It's like, just it's, in a sense, it's someone who brought it, not just bang on, but brought up something very early that made them feel in a very particular way, and it's kind of like that almost ecstatic way that people feel, you know, when that happens.
Sure. You have been very generous audience. We are running like an hour late, and so grateful that you're here. I'd rather stop talking. I'd like to know if you have a question for me. Like, I want you to talk to me or something like that. Because that's something. If you feel like, please. Okay. Thank you. Do you need a mic? Because we can't hear you. I can't. No.
I just wonder what you kind of describe yourself as hiding away when you're in the box.
But to me, it seems that you're kind of really exposed somehow. But I just wondered what's going on in your mind when you're in this box for hours on end and you can't see anything. And I just wondered how you sustain that duration.
How I feel when I stand in the inside. I feel extremely hot and thousands of mosquitoes around me. Yeah, and before I doing this performance, I know something will be happen. It's something like security guys or collision, some pedestrian collision, but I still have to do this, because if something happened, I think all the events will be happened, it will be the part of my work, and maybe it will enrich the work itself.
Thank you for sharing your work today. I guess it's a question for the panel and a question for the artists that have spoken before as well. And I was interested in unpacking the title of this symposium, Encountering Difference, because what I've heard, which has been really inspiring between the collaboration with the artists, is that you chose each other because you connected and you found something that resonated, rather than like purposely looking for difference and whether... And just sort of, yeah, unpacking that. Because for me, like looking at all of the artists now, aside from the superficiality of our external colour, race, gender, what's the real difference? I mean, I think it's age. I don't know. I find it really refreshing that you have students who still have not graduated, with PhD researchers, with artists who've practiced for 40 years or whatever. I find that difference is really interesting, thing that's being discussed with in this symposium. But really, it's about what is difference, and are we really discussing it in this symposium? Yeah.
I think we were one. I mean, we saw each other like a month ago, and we spent like 2 hours something discussing like actually that what you just asked, like how choosing each other and finding affinities with people and connecting with people could be linked to finding difference, or, you know, because, like, from the, I don't know, like, a very shallow way to, I mean, the first impression you have is, like, when you match with someone, it's because you're alike, or you feel you have similarities. So we're discussing, like, are we actually, like, do we actually feel about it, and whether, how could we find difference if we acted? But I thought it was, like, very experimental, and I think that the conclusion we came to was what she said, like there are so many differences in like facts or contexts, or, you know, like where you come from, the things you like, the things you do, your work, your age, your nationality, all these things. But you know, when you get to talk to people, you can find similarities no matter with who. I thought that was really important. And, you know, it can be extended not only in art practices or artists. I think it applies to everything, really.
While you're saying that this was a sort of a together collaboration, three of you, but I didn't see that, unfortunately. I just saw three different presentations. The only couples I saw before ourselves was Carl. Right? You too, because the whole process was how our differences become something else. Because I do artist talk in museum, and that's a 2 hours, an hour talk. But here we became something else. It became something that is not me, and that's not Carl. Carl became me, sort of, and I became him. But I saw that only in another presentation. I wasn't here in the morning, apologies for that. But the only one I saw apart from Carl was another one in the afternoon, you two guys. I enjoyed, because that was the purpose of what we were invited to do. So it was to become something out of yours. Like, I was really uncomfortable. I didn't know how to introduce myself. Like, I went, it's a very difficult position to be, because you don't know that work. It's not your work. It's somebody else's, with all those area of thinking. But here I saw three artist presentation of yours, which is not what we were, I think, supposed to do. No?
Well, I don't think there's a supposed to do or have to end. Yeah, yeah. No, I think we've witnessed today that difference is so complex. Yeah. I think one of the good things that we witnessed is that tension. I'm sure everyone's going to be still talking about the view of, is it Caroline Malloy's work? And I think that is difference in itself anyway, and it shows you that, you know, that one image can be so loaded, and for different people it's going to mean things. So I think that's definitely one of the good to think that intergenerational difference is something that is, for me, has arisen from today as well. But I think there's so many different, excuse the pun, ways of reading this. And it's nice when things do work and you can see those commonalities, but also when you don't see those commonalities as well, there's something in that as well. So I think that's the beauty of difference. Okay. Yes.
Yeah, in response to what you just said, I think we didn't, I mean, we had so little time to actually put a work together, but I think it's not finished. And I agree with what you just said, because, you know, like the conversations we had, they were so improbable or so impossible if it weren't for this. You know, like I was thinking, like the situation, like a Chinese girl, an Italian girl, a Colombian girl, we speak different, struggling with English. And then what happens when you put these people together? Or how did we actually get to choose each other? We have nothing in common, apparently. So the discussion that, and our conversations and everything, which of course we didn't have the time to put like a work together or something like for this occasion, but I thought it was like a really, it was really something, and it's not, I don't think we will need to further conversation and update, and we will show you hopefully something sometime. But I thought it was really
just to point out,
okay.
The original title of this was wasn't it?
It's encounter. Yes.
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 Can I just say, I really enjoyed your presentations, and I thought it was absolutely brilliant. Coming from an kind of older generation, to actually hear your approaches to difference is so refreshing. I so enjoyed it. It was so diverse, but so interesting, and I'd love to collaborate with you at some point. It's absolutely amazing. I really enjoyed your presentations. Fantastic way of kind of dealing with, you know, being in London, meeting each other, us being here, and having a conversation between three of you, and, you know, kind of hopefully with all of us from other places, and we connect here in London, looking at each other's work, and looking at difference, which is, I mean, I find you guys really interesting, and there's a lot of shared spaces, and your approach is fantastic. Thank you so much. Thanks, Opie, for this.
Thank you. Any other
Hi, I am Rafael, study here at Camberwell, and I like the idea of art was mentioned. I want to know more about the criteria, because an archive is something large, something huge, so it's really impossible to explore all of that, and also it's something that is hidden, and it's something that it should be visible in some way. So can you tell me, someone of you, about your criteria? Because also it was mentioned about NASA archive, it was mentioned about some scientist process, and so I want to know about how do you select something, how do you think that that is powerful, that it should be seen for many people. Tell me something about it.
Well, in my case, as I said, for example, in the work about the Scotland Archive, I went to visit all the archive I could. It was a bit problematic because I had to send emails for 2 or 3 months in advance, resend them again and again. And then when I was able to see the material, I mean, obviously at the end, I just have to see the material. And a lot of archives, they just had images from like too recent for what I was looking for the period. So basically it was just looking physically in different cities. And then when I found this archive, what I did is, again, other 3 or 4 months of emails to have the permission to go there and film. And eventually I did selection for, I focus on the images. And so basically I went through, I stayed there like a week. And every day I was there for approximately 5 or 6 hours. And so I did, that was the amount of time I had. And so I filmed, I looked at the albums, for example, some albums are just text or documents. So I just made a criteria base, on the imagery in that case. But then material as well. So my limitation was time in that case, because this is a huge archive. But I selected, let's say in a row, you would have, for example, if you have 20 albums about ships and boats and fishing, I would make like a selection of 10, but then trying to cover all the subject. And in other case, when I work with archival material, so archival video, I didn't show to you, but sometimes I do. The archive collection, which is online archive of home movies, American home movies, anonymous from the 1920s to the 1980s. And in that case, for example, for some of my works, I watched all these videos. Like we're speaking about 300 videos. So sometimes it takes me 2 years to work on a video because I'm very methodical. If I have at disposition all the archive, it's a lot of work, of course, because then eventually maybe you have a 15-minute videos, but then the editing process that's behind that is looking at all these hours. So this is my answer, but maybe someone else has.
I think your question is really, really important, really interesting, and it might not seem evident from my work, but I do ask myself that question every time, you know, with archives and with all the information we choose something, why is this more relevant than others? And, you know, I struggle a lot with that, and I choose in my work to work with like latent archives. Mm-hmm. Which for me is like people, really. You know, you're like a living archive. You're full of people, and everybody is. So I like to work with people and to make yourself like part of my works and like in this interactive installations or the work I do, just to make you realize that, like how you're full of all this temporality and information, like you're a latent archive.
One of the things we talked about when we were presenting was the idea of agency, of how you choose, how you select from the numerous footages. So I think you can also elaborate on that, the idea of you with the number.
So, I point of view, and I think actually this is kind of relevant. This is relevant from Azadeh's point of view in terms of her approach. There's a similarity. It kind of comes from, in a sense, relates back to kind of personal memory, comes to memory, I think. And I think archives are, you know, obviously fantastically interesting because they allow you to kind of reinterpret your own experience, particularly if you have a connection, direct connection with them. And that obviously comes from an interest. And I think in kind of remediating archive is a great thing to do. If you're connected with it, because it allows you to kind of it allows you to ask all sorts of questions that you may not be aware that you're actually already asking, if you see what I mean, of yourself, and it allows you to find out answers to questions that are kind of integral to the way you relate to things, and I kind of relate that back to like the idea of formative experiences. So for me, something like NASA missions is a way that I kind of interpret, explore a kid who grew up, who was born in the mid-60s, who remembers sitting on my father's knee to watch the Apollo missions, and then experienced that up to the kind of early 70s. you know, in your own house, the kind of first universe that you ever experience, the first kind of place on earth that you are kind of a part of, that you investigate. So it's kind of, for me, it remediates all of that. So I'm kind of using something like the NASA archive just as a way to kind of, at this point in my life, kind of go back into my childhood and reinterpret something that is a kind of part of my formative self, if you see what I mean. But more importantly, it's about what I do in my practice, actually, funnily enough. There's the thing that I came to realize is that they're basically on a journey. You know, I'm really into the idea of journeys as narratives, you know, that you through your life. And it's a dynamic process that you kind of you kind of keep going back. In the discussion today, it was about reaffirmation of points of kind of coming back to the place where you once began, you know, in a sense. You have to kind of go out to the limit of things, and you have these limit experiences about things to kind of come back to the same place to recognize what's really important. Because the power of youth is the ability to kind of see it all, understand it all, but actually know, not truly, and I don't mean this in a derogatory sense, but not truly know what it really means. Because you have to have experience of the longevity of things to be able to understand that. So I think that's what archives really do, is that you kind of reconceptualize your own past through the past that has been. And they're very powerful things, that's for sure.
So we do. So let's give everyone a round of applause. Thank you, everyone. Okay, right. Thank you.